Hi everybody. So you're looking at a map right here of all the oil tankers. I was having some trouble trying to figure some things out, and just decided to do a refresher of like basically what's going on in the oil industry, and just look at basically everything. So right here we can kind of see all the oil tankers, and there is a whole bunch of oil tankers you can basically see right here kind of in the Middle East. Certainly there's a lot right here kind of in the south side of America and in between Latin America. You can kind of see a bunch kind of off the coast of China and in Oceania. And then just kind of some ones here along the coast of Africa and South America, and then of course in Europe. So of these, you can kind of say it looks like Middle East and down here Houston area, and then along the coast kind of in Asia here. So what I did is just transition here. So I got kind of this data from Wikipedia, and it says list of largest oil and gas companies by revenue. So I did a little bit of magic and calculated some things. So I grabbed that and kind of redid it by country, so you can kind of see the aggregated numbers. And I double checked this to make sure that it was approximately correct. But it, essentially you can see Saudi Arabia here with about 8%, 8.5. Netherlands being about another 8%. So interestingly, basically Saudi Arabia and Netherlands kind of splitting this. And if you look at the original history of some of the companies coming out of Amsterdam area, they originally were partnered with basically the Middle East. So really, when you look at proximity and everything, Netherlands and Middle East, and you know, they're basically very closely located. China, on the other hand, is very far away from everything, but yet it still has a fairly big chunk here, more than Saudi Arabia, you can see. And United Kingdom with a good 6.8% for an island. And you can kind of compare this to Japan. So you can see Japan here being about 3%, right? So they're both islands. And about maybe half of the oil business is that are in United Kingdom are in Japan. So China certainly is doing a heavier deal with oil than Japan. And certainly here you see the United States with 17.5%. So this almost looks like 25% of the total oil revenues. And then interestingly, you see France here, and then Russia and India. So I would say the big surprise actually was, it shouldn't be a surprise, but actually India, seeing India about the same size as Russia. From what I understand, Europe is now getting a lot of their oil from Russia. And then you can see there's a little slice here for Iran being almost the same size as Brazil. So if we go back to the map, you'll see a couple things now. And then interestingly here, you see Mexico and even Kuwait having a huge little chunk here. Kuwait is just a small, tiny little country. Just about the size of, say, Manhattan even. So, but yet still having about 1.6% of the total oil market. So Italy here, surprisingly, pretty large area. You'd say that Italy's, comparable to Japan, and yet 1.6%. Thailand being a curious one here, but anyone that knows about Thailand knows that there's a lot of business there. However, there's also a lot of pollution. And then you can see Azerbaijan, and that's a kind of interesting one to see here. And then Spain and Indonesia. So, and then Indonesia being kind of really questionable, right? Because there's just such a huge population here in Indonesia. Greece being in here as well. There's a lot of shipping companies coming out of Greece, and then that's pretty much it for these. So if you go back to the specific companies, which might be interesting, this is kind of the plot here, but here's kind of the specific companies that data came from. And you can kind of see that Saudi Arabia here, row that shell, and China is kind of really high here. So this is China National Petroleum, and BP, ExxonMobil, Total SA. So basically what happened here is this data says the country here. So if we look at Total, for example, Total SA, which I was kind of interested in, they're in France, right? So and you might want to compare them to, say, Italy with ENI, right? So I had to kind of guesstimate some of these numbers here. So I took just an average increase, and it was about 12% from this year to this year. So I kind of estimated what these numbers are. So they're not totally accurate, but they're as accurate as we can get. I'd have to, otherwise I'd have to go into all the financial reports and get that all the data myself. Be interested to see what the 2020 and 21 numbers are. So you can see by the companies here, kind of the slice. And the question is, as this really tapers off, you might say that there's still another good chunk of, say, even 8, 7, 8, 10% left of the world's economy. So these are the major ones, but there might even still be even upwards of 10% of the rest of the oil might be really small producers. We don't even know. So this is not the full picture anyway. And then you can kind of see a log graph where this is split at 400 billion and then 200 billion. So you can kind of see some of this other stuff. So kind of right around in here. So these are kind of the bigger ones, and then kind of a drop off. But I was just kind of looking for curious what was going on with this. As you look at this whole map, there's just so much going on here. I would say Europe is really interesting in general. So from the numbers, let me just go back to these numbers really quick here so you can see. So from these numbers, essentially a couple of the curious ones, obviously the United States is the biggest and most important. But after that, basically China off the coast. So we kind of want to look at China here, and even I would say India and Russia. So if we just go back to this other map, so basically the United States is number one. So let's just look at the United States first, too, so you can kind of see where all these oil tankers are coming in and out of, and really not a whole lot along the West Coast here, and not a whole lot kind of coming here. Now you can see these pathways, so you can kind of see there's kind of a pathway. These are all the shipping routes, so it may not always be oil. So this particular route might be an oil route because you see a lot of little tankers on there, and then kind of coming in through here. So interestingly, at this time of day and night, you can kind of see what's going on here. So this shows you kind of Panama Canal and heading out here. So it'd be interesting to see exactly. So you can kind of see kind of the general flow, not really in or out, and then kind of looking right here all into Houston. Interesting thing about Houston is if you look in here, they actually go quite far into Houston. A lot of the boats wait on the outside and then kind of pull in. There's a little bay here into Houston. So these little dots show pretty far in. So they kind of wait on this edge, and then there's some refineries there. So that is a very important spot. And you can also see even up in here in Louisiana and also in Alabama and the other areas. So interestingly, basically that's what I would say is that as we think about the American oil supply, where is it underground? I can kind of show you an image of that in a second. But let's just look at let me pause this for a second here. So unfortunately I couldn't really find it, but if you go to Wikipedia's page, you can find the oil reserves, and they kind of show here. You can see Saudi Arabia, and even Venezuela having a huge amount, and this is billions of barrels. The data is a little bit old here, so they do have another map if you scroll down a little bit further, showing this thing, and this also kind of gives you the same basic idea, but you can see Nigeria here, and we didn't even see Nigeria in the data. So in terms of profits, so here you kind of see by region, so this kind of makes it a little bit more clear. So Middle East, Central and South America having a huge chunk. So profits should probably be divided up about like this, right? So, and even Middle East kind of being a part, a lot of it being part of Africa as well. So you might say, and then Eurasia, kind of an Oceania. So this part of Oceania is basically, it's great that there's only a small part, because means you can't really pollute the waters if there was a vast oil spill. And Europe having an extremely small slice. So, you know, essentially the Middle East has been feeding Europe, obviously, and South America, essentially, and North America. So this looks like a big, almost 33%. So one out of every three barrels is basically coming from the West, which is Central, South America, and North America, and basically half from the Middle East here. So yeah, this is a great graph, and it's 2013. I wish I could get my other picture. Let me see if I can still get that. So the funny thing is I still can't find what I'm looking for, but right here, if you grab this on the Harvard Atlas of Economic Complexity, which is really great, this data should essentially match up with this data, right? So, and I actually kind of trust this a little bit more because I use this more often, and it's pretty detailed and pretty complex. So right here you can see Europe. Now it shows Europe with a pretty big slice here of the total energy market. And then here you can kind of see Saudi Arabia, Kuwait, Iran, and we can even get a global map, which will hopefully load this up. So this shows kind of a little more detail in terms of where this is over time, and we might even be able to get this by country. So kind of see that the total value of the oil has definitely dropped here and then kind of picked up here. So and unfortunately, if you look at this, there's coal, agate, peat, there's a whole petroleum gases, petroleum jelly, and even a bunch of these others. So I'm not sure if this is gonna be exactly what we are looking for. So I did try chemicals here. So if you look at chemicals, it just isn't quite what we're looking for, because this includes some other things as well. So we could probably do vehicles and see approximately some details here. This will show Japan and some other ones. So here we got Japan being quite a heavy vehicle operator. So it's probably going to be under minerals, and then under minerals we want to do this one. So this is 27 HS2. So but basically that's the data. So I think between Wikipedia and this, so you can kind of see that, yeah, that's about 50% of the economy. And here you can also see Australia, and I'm familiar with Australia, and I definitely wanted to see them on this map, just because I know they're doing a lot of mining. So, and then here you can kind of see Nigeria actually not being as significant as it shows here. So here it shows about 8%, and yeah, that's maybe 8%. So probably about right. And then this United States, Canada, let's see, 10%. 13%. Yeah, so maybe this is about right. And then up here it shows the total value of about $2 trillion for the economy. And we might even be able to slip this into 2018. Yeah, look at that. So numbers have changed. So for some reason it doesn't load it as this. So we can still see pretty similar numbers, and it looks like Saudi Arabia took a bigger, and UAE are pretty big here. So kind of surprises, like India, right? You can see only 1% here, and then even China, like, where are they? Gosh, South America. So, oh yeah. So this is reserves. So I'm sorry. So the difference here is that this is the reserves, meaning the amount of oil that's left, and this is the exported value. So yeah, so totally different concepts. So basically, you have to kind of look at that carefully. So that's exports. And then if you look at imports, you see actually China and India show up and they don't even show up. Interesting. So here you got the exports about 1%, and China and India pretty heavily dependent on oil there, and even America obviously you see exporting about 7% of the world supply and importing about 8.7 something, and this is undeclared, so maybe some other places. So certainly what we could do is look at this. So on the import side, you can see Russia not really importing a whole lot, and then kind of in Germany here importing quite a bit, and actually yeah, so quite a bit. About Germany imports half of what the United States does. Big question there. China actually doing about 300 billion, and United States being at around 200. And on the export side, you can just look at this again. So you can see we're doing at about 188 billion. And some little details here, just to look on the export side, so you can see. I'm really afraid about the Oceania area, but certainly in the Middle East, just because there's a lot of nice water in here, we want to keep it clean. So you can see definitely Russia, and then here's Norway, right, with a good 68 billion. And then you can see here Netherlands, actually this little tiny speck doing more than all of Norway. So in terms of exports, so clearly they are cutting some deals to get that. Maybe they refine it there. I don't know. So we could look in here and see. So on the export side, so we basically saw that Norway had a pretty big. So when you look at this atlas here, I think we can zoom in a little bit and kind of see. So kind of compare this with the actual shipping routes, and you can kind of see. They're just kind of pulling in a lot of oil into that region, and most of the population there in Europe is actually in that area. So I could show you a population map. So, and if you want to look at Asia here, you can see exports, and probably the important thing would be imports on this Asian side. So Korea, South Korea actually importing quite a lot of oil, I would say, for such a small country. And man, I've looked at Seoul, and it's not a good situation. A lot of people need to move out of Seoul, which is right here, maybe down to Busan or something. But and even Taiwan having quite a lot of oil there. India, and this is all on the import side. So you can see Nigeria importing some oil, and then even Egypt here, and Brazil kind of doing. Wow, about what Egypt is doing. So, not a whole lot of imports in Brazil. And then you can see doing more exports there. And for all the oil that they say is reserved in South America, they certainly are not. Ooh, did I just. Yeah, so. But yeah, so this on the export side, South America should be 20% of everything. So if we zoom out, but anyway, just to get you a basic idea. So I hope that this has been interesting for you. I'm just trying to think of anything else to discuss in the last couple of minutes here. But on this African side in Eurasia, so this essentially the biggest slice of this puzzle that's really missing is Asia on the reserves. There's not a whole lot of oil in Asia. So that causes a very important problem, but a good thing, because there's so many people and they really shouldn't be using a lot of oil. It's just oil's bad sometimes, but in general, it's not. So if you look at the shipping map around Africa, I was just looking at. So here's the Suez Canal. A lot of this kind of going up into the Mediterranean. You can kind of see what's going on there. So Africa should have about a good 10%, and which isn't a whole lot when you think about it. But being so close to the Middle East. So the Middle East is right in here, right? So there's basically this lake of oil here. So it just kind of is interesting to think about. So certainly a lot of ships in this area. But if I added all the ships, you guys would probably be pretty surprised. And then just kind of seeing what's been going on here in China. So certainly China, it looks like quite a lot of stuff down here in Shanghai, right? And then this is the Yellow Sea, and you can kind of see maybe most of the people in China live right in here. Let me give you a population map really quick so you can see. Okay, so this is a population map. So you can kind of see in Europe, in Asia, there's just a ton of people here. So if you look at, let me change the opacity just a little bit here to see. Oops, gotta get this guy. So if you bring in the land areas, you can kind of see the population relative to Europe. So there's just a ton of people in here, right? And basically when you consider, so there's a lot of oil companies kind of coming out of here, and then you can kind of see in the Middle East where these population, and this gets into Iraq, which is actually quite populated now that I think about it, and quite a number of people down here, interestingly, and a lot of people here, and then this is capital Saudi Arabia, but not a whole lot of people, but I mean, there's actually about a billion people in Africa, but on this, it just makes it look just so many people, so not terribly. And then here you can kind of see in South America and even in North America. So when you take that into consideration, so basically that was kind of the shipping, right? And you can kind of grab this. So, you know, if you're looking at the shipping area here, you can kind of see that the population and this. So, yeah, so basically the population is really heavy in India and also in China in this region. So does the shipping match with that? Well, it looks like most of the shipping matches with the oil reserves, and is it really being taken in? So on the import side, well, it says they're importing the most here in India, and actually India must be really struggling. And I would say that India's got to be able to work some deals with the Middle East, just because they are so dependent. They don't have any oil there. And yet, man, are they importing a lot of oil. So that is maybe one reason why the Indian oil company, Reliance, I think it is basically the most important company in India. They're just importing a lot of oil. So that's a big project for them. You can see Italy here importing, and on the export side, so actually India does show quite a lot of exports, I hope this has been interesting to see, let me know what kind of ideas. And one last thing, sorry about this. So this is a if you haven't seen this, it's called Gas Buddy, and they show the prices, and I don't know if this is quite, this is basically live. So I think people go on their web app, their phone, and they kind of say, hey, this is the prices. So you kind of see West Coast being a little more expensive, and then here in Pennsylvania being expensive. And then cheapest down in Houston. So you saw all that shipping kind of coming into south there, and you might even be able to buy a gallon, I guess, for $1.59 or so down in Houston, whereas in California, pretty much all it's about $3 a gallon. So kind of a range, almost twice that. I wonder even if you could just buy it and resell it in California. Maybe that's what's going on here. They buy it and drive it. So, you can also see Florida being a little bit pricey, and that would be interesting just to see why that is. Maybe just no refining going on. This is a cool little website, Gas Buddy. And I think that's about it. That's all I got on this. There's a map that I was trying to get that just shows all the oil, kind of like a picture of where the oil is, but couldn't quite find that. For now, hope everything is going great. I would say there's a lot of things to think about in the world, and I was kind of interested in specific companies. Oh yeah, so let me actually go back to that. So I did. If you need to try to find like companies that you are interested in, you can go to this free stock screener. And what I did is I edited this. So I went to Yahoo and then clicked screeners here and created my own screener. And I did mega cap, large cap, mid cap to kind of get the bigger companies here. And I did the sector of energy. So you can add, they have different sectors here. I just picked energy. And you can do kind of a sub industry. So if you wanted to do energy, and there's just so many different sectors here. So, I don't know why it has some of these listed, but some of them, maybe it's just a mistake. But anyway, and then you can sort this by market cap or even PE. I can't sort it by that, but you can do by volume and the price. So perhaps the most interesting is market cap. So it's sorted by market cap. So you can see, at least on the American Stock Exchange, ExxonMobil is the biggest. So let me just graph these really quick. Okay, so I'm back. This took me about 20 minutes or so, maybe even longer. Basically, I grabbed all the data from Yahoo, and it turns out that this is about 150 or so companies, and these are the largest ones pretty much in the world that are also tradable on the New York Stock Exchange. Also some ADRs in here. You can see Gazprom and some others. So I'll try to link this to the posting. In general, you can see what I did is I grabbed the market cap and volumes and then graphed that. So that's this data. So there's basically 150 or so dots here. So as you go this way, you get up in market capitalization. And as you go this way, you go volume. And this is very recent data. So this is volume pretty much in the last 3 months. And this is 2020. So this data should be pretty accurate, hopefully. And I put it on a log graph so you can kind of see what it looks like. So this company is the largest company in the world, and these are getting smaller and smaller as you move this way. And you can kind of see that there's definitely a side you want to be, hopefully more volume means more interest in your company. So it's kind of scary. I'm a little bit worried that some of this is due to algorithmic trading. So there's basically companies that are being traded a lot and then companies that are being traded less. And in general, it looks like a lot of these dots are in this range here, which is not a good sign necessarily for the oil industry, because that means less people are interested. So some of these are only traded 10,000 shares per day. And even these about 1,000 shares a day. So you could go ahead and click on one of these and then find out the dots. The nice part I like about this graph is you can start to think about, aha, so it looks like these guys are kind of smaller companies, not even small, but below $10 billion in market capitalization. And they're also traded in the tens of millions, or what is that? That's 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. Yeah, 10 million shares. This is a million shares, and this is 100,000. So you can kind of see there's kind of a sweet spot right around here, about 5 million for these guys, and then certainly down here. Now, I'm interested in all kinds, so I like to trade some foreign stocks sometimes. And if you look at these, you'll see some of these have Y's at the end, and some of them have F. So basically, the difference here is that this would be like a Chinese one here, or here F. So F is a foreign bank, and it's not always like this, but basically, I'm pretty sure it is. Y is an American bank. So usually, the American ones are slightly cheaper to trade than the foreign ones, because there's exchange rates, and you just but at the same time, it is nice to trade the stocks directly. None of these are traded directly if they are foreign. So you can see there's always some kind of weird exchange rate. And I'm not even really trustworthy of these kind of things where you have these ADRs. How's that exactly work? Is it calculated differently? It's prone to mistakes, I would imagine, but maybe it works perfectly. Who knows? You can see the prices in this column for most of these stocks. So, if you wanted to do, let me do one more for float, just to. So, what I'm going to do is basically figure out the total dollars that are traded per day, and I just have to do a calculation for that really quick. So, I'm not going to go into a whole lot more detail than this. This was kind of just a lot of extra data science. So, on this, I did percent float. So, basically, what I did is I calculated two more columns, dollars floating per day, and that's simply just taking the average volume times the price. And then the percent float, what I did is I just calculated, took the dollars floating per day, divided that by the market capitalization. So, long story short, you get this graph. And think about it, and you'll realize that I did it exactly correct. But basically, you can see, so as the volume increases, the percentage float basically increases. So that should make sense to you, but it's not always the case. So there's kind of these two groups. There's kind of even a subgroup here, a group here, and a group here. So there are a cluster of companies where the volume is like 1% is floating, and you can see it's slightly above that average line. So that shows that obviously this volume increases. So if you want to look at everything that I got, this is all the data. So you can see market capitalization dropping here on this line. So this is market capitalization, average volume, float per day, and percent float. So you can kind of see percent float is actually the hardest one to estimate, but in general, as the market cap, you can kind of see these waves, right? It's this kind of here and here, and this is probably because of different investment profiles, like people investing in this group, in this group, and then kind of a lower group in these spots. And then you can see, obviously, so I had to do a log graph on this side to get this, and you can see in general the average volume decreasing as the market cap decreases. And that to me is kind of a bad sign. I think that for the economy in general, you want to see that average volume stays at least flat or even helps the smaller companies. But in general, volume is going towards the bigger companies. And you can see it's not always the case because there's some ups and downs. And this is certainly not a steady line down, but it is kind of, and you can see the float dollars floating per day also is dropping, and that obviously should make a lot of sense because obviously more market cap you have. You see up here, this is like in I don't even know, is $1 billion, 10, 100 million, I'm not even sure. So it's a big number, 100 million maybe, or even a billion. So some of these companies at the larger market caps are trading a lot of money every day. So I would look at percentage float. So this, To me, if you really want to have a lot of volatility, you want to be up in this range. So that's why I grabbed the percentage float one here, because this one will probably be most interesting to most people. So that way you can say, aha, I'm want to take a more conservative approach and maybe look for a lower percentage float per day. So that way the company can't really change a lot in price as much. But with 1% of the total shares trading per day, there's only a few of those, and you can see the volume. So, but in general, less volume, less floating per day, but that doesn't necessarily mean sometimes lower volume can hurt you. So it's really a trade-off. In general, you want to be kind of a higher volume. So as you push this way, you can see that there's a higher percentage float. But anyway, so there's a lot of data, and then again, this just goes back to the fundamentals of just market capitalization and volume. So you can see just a slight increase, right? This could even, some people would say, that doesn't matter, like, or there's even a U shape here, or there's a flatter line here for these guys that are trading at higher volumes. So higher, you might divide this data up, and certainly that'd be worth it. But some of the interesting points, like this point, might be connected with this, or this point in here might be connected with this lower graph on these guys. So it is interesting just to see the scatter plot. And wow, so we've come a long way. I think I've been going on here for 30 minutes or so, but this all has to do with oil, right? So what's going on? We looked at this data analysis, we looked at the shipping, and we looked at the Atlas. And certainly this is a really fun thing to look at. And you certainly would like to look at the exports and imports, so you can kind of see this other market really showing up as a major market share actually on the import side. So that would be, like Oceania, small islands, who knows what the name of the country is. So there's a lot of things just to look at on all these kinds of data maps, imports and exports and so on. And I highly recommend this as a chart, to make sure you select 2018. I don't even think they got anything more that we can do than 2018. And I think we might even be able to do kind of a show this over time since 1990s or so, and this is on the import side. So you can kind of see America having a whopping 18% of the imports around 2000, and then just changing here and kind of decreasing. Yeah, so there's little animations like this that you might be able to try as well. And certainly, what I would do is look at particular countries that you're interested in. Like, I'm particularly interested in, let's say, Oceania or something. You can isolate this and see, aha, so Australia is a big chunk of Oceania. And this is on imports, right? Or you can see on Africa, okay, so South Africa and Egypt, Nigeria, and so on. Or you can, I don't know why it's did that, but and then, like, if I wanted to Asia, I can see China is a big percentage of that, and so on. And South America is showing this for South America, Brazil taking a huge chunk there, and interestingly, Chile, Peru, Venezuela, and so on. So, and then there's these other categories, and so on. And even in North America, you can see America taking a huge chunk. And look at that, Panama, and you can see some other ones. So, certainly, there's a lot of data here. So, go through it and try to see. And certainly, the Wikipedia page is great. So, but in terms of reserves, there's a map that I was trying to get for you, just looking at a picture of the overall Earth and just seeing, like, where the oil is. It's a really interactive map, and you might be able to get that for a GeoTIFF. Could try to get that at some point, but I think I'm pretty much done for this. I hope you really enjoyed it. I had fun. I learned a bit. I was trying to kind of graph some things here. Sorry if that got a little complicated, but I'll try to post a link for this here. I'm really interested in what your thoughts are. And just what's going on in the oil industry and what your thoughts are. Just for interesting markets, particularly I would say in Africa would be super interesting to hear your ideas. South America here looking like it has quite a lot of oil and yet not a whole lot of the profits. So, when you go back and you look at the graph for the different countries in terms of profits, these two graphs, this is kind of all right. So Saudi Arabia, well, they have a lot of it. Why are they only getting 8%? So they have 45% of the reserves. So I would say there's some starving people in Africa and Saudi Arabia. Can they work with Africa and try to balance out some of the profits, right? So is it and obviously Europeans, if they're selling mainly to Europeans, they want to have some of the profit too, but yet United Kingdom here and some others. So but how do we kind of look at Asia too? So India here and China, they don't really have a whole lot of the reserves, right? So there's really Eurasia here and Oceania. So I would say Eurasia, is that considered part of the Middle East, or is that Russia? I mean, I don't know. So and Europe only has 1%. So it's just a lot of data to look at and kind of compromise and thinking about, particularly when you see really nothing for South America, right? This small slice of the profit, yet 20%. So how can they even start helping other parts of the world with some of these profits? So as these profit numbers kind of redistribute, I would say even in North America, this is about correct, right? So we're just at 17.5%, but we have 13%. So maybe slightly high, but around in the ballpark of the right range. So North America should have quite a big percentage of the profit. Maybe not quite this percentage, but less, slightly less. And then certainly it's not about profit even, because it's about working together. So I am interested in Greece in particular. Really great country, they have a great little slice there of the pie, but certainly they're in the Mediterranean, and nice place to live and work. Japan is also super interesting, and Brazil, and even trying to help our neighbors Mexicans here, like how do they get a bigger slice of this as well? So but what is the correct numbers as well? So anyway, I hope you really enjoyed it. I had some fun time. I hope it even maybe will solve some problems in the future. And there's just a ton of ships out there. So take a look at this map for sure. You can take a look at the marine traffic here on this page. And then there's some little things you got to click on to get it to look like this. But you might want to do the base map and then do satellite map and so on. But anyway, that's about it. So, see you later. Let me know what you think. Hope you enjoyed it.